if you enter into thinking about Islam as a tradition, a lively tradition of people arguing, right, then you're not caught in that whole trap of being shocked that there are differences internal to Islam and thinking that this is a sign of weakness, either political or spiritual. Previously, I used to work on Pakistan, and now I work much more on Bangladesh. Yes. In India, there's been a long-standing conflict over a mosque there, which has been the site of a lot of contestations between Muslim groups, but also Hindu right, etc. And the mosque is called Babri Masjid. And the Babri Masjid, the first round of really spectacular violence around it, and also the construction of a temple on its site, happened around the same time as I was looking for a new field project to get ready to go to the field. And that completely changed my mind about wanting to go to India, which is what I had thought of initially. And so I completely reoriented towards Pakistan. And that was an unusual choice because I was born and brought up in Bangladesh, and Bangladesh has very, very ambivalent, if not, feelings of animosity towards Pakistan because of the fact that we were one country once, and then we fought a war of independence to separate from Pakistan, right? So I thought, I'll go study Pakistan, I'll get to learn a new language, and it'll be a good test for me, because it'll be a test for whether I can overcome my own national upbringing, my own nationalist sentiments, and just study this country like a place. When I arrived in Pakistan, I started to do field work. My initial project was to look at the modernist architecture of the new capital building that had been built from scratch for Pakistan, Islamabad. And in the process of studying that, and I was also living in Lahore, learning Urdu, etc., I realized that I was much more interested in the fact that, you know, the local mosques in the neighborhood I was living in were involved in this kind of tussle, you know, between different groups, right? And the sudden realization, having grown up in Bangladesh, where I always thought that there was just like one Islam, right? To suddenly realize that there's actually quite a lot of difference internal to Islam, and that, you know, that's not necessarily a bad thing. That's part of its history, and that's also part of its richness. The interesting thing is, being in Bangladesh, which is still a Muslim majority country, and even though I'm in a very rural, very, very rural setting, right, what I realized is that there's such a vibrant relationship between everyday life and Islam, but very different from Pakistan, right? That the Islam in Bangladesh, of course, you know, it's in the tradition, so it's recognizably Islam, but that it is a very lively conversation, not with different parts of Islam, but with Buddhism, with Hinduism, with, you know, all different Christianity. And so here I am in the villages, and I'm paying attention to, you know, how they fish and how they farm, etc., and how they live with moving land. But at the same time, I'm really interested that the azan is called at all different times when there is, you know, fear of a flood. I just wrote a paper just like 2 weeks ago, which is based on this figure who I encounter in the field, who's written about, actually. I mean, there's a folklorist whom I met in the field, and he talks about meeting this man who is the imam of a local mosque, right? And the imam of the local mosque gives him an account of each month of the year, each of the Bengali seasons, and each of the days of the week. And he weaves together, you know, like Bengali folklore and literary references and Islamic references into his description of the seasons, right? And there's a very beautiful passage, which I translated for the paper, in which he uses the words, Bengali words, for things like leaves and trees, etc., to arrive at this description that what is a tree but a lot of limbs asking God for air and water, etc., right? And it's a really beautiful imagery, right? And I was thinking, you know, we need such imagery, right? We don't just need to be told that we need trees because trees are good for the environment and is good for the quality of air we breathe and for the shade it brings, etc. We need to be able to see the tree as a supplicant of a certain kind. One shouldn't go to study a religion, because the word religion is actually of secular creation, and it's to tear apart something, a set of practices, a set of, you know, or habitus, you know, relations, etc., and to separate it out violently from other domains of life, call it politics or the public sphere, whatever. So avoid going to study something as a religion, and it's much better if you study it as a tradition.